Hi, this is Gary Cassette again, and I want to tell one of my stories involving some guests at the school. I go to most of the award shows, the major ones, and then other award shows during the year. So one of the award shows I used to go to faithfully was the Comedy Awards. It was on yearly. I think they did it for a long time, and they eventually stopped doing it. So one year I was attending the Comedy Awards, and it's an evening, and they have comedians come up and do routines, give out awards for most popular comedian, most popular nightclub comedian. So as I'm standing, backstage, we're not, show's on the break, people are going to the bathroom getting a drink. This woman walked by me. I didn't know who she was, but there was something interesting, attractive about her. And I said, hi, I'm Gary. She said, what's your name? And she said her name. I didn't know what her name was. I said, I, what do you do? I didn't mean, I said, she said, well, I do stand-up comedy. I said, I travel the country and, pretty popular. And then I said, I don't know why I said this, I said all of a sudden I looked at her and I said, is that all you do? She said, she didn't like that. So what do you mean all I do? Well, I mean, do you act? She said, no. And I said, well, are you a TV film? She said, no, I do stand-up comedy. So why did you ask that? I said, I don't know. I just think maybe you should be. And then she really didn't like that comment. It was like, I'm telling her business and she doesn't do it. She said, I make a lot of money doing this and that's what I do. I said, what would you say that for? I said, just something about equality, something I can't even explain what it is. She says, I just don't know what you're talking about. So I stopped talking to her. I was trying to be complimentary and she took it a different way. So I didn't think much of it. And then years later, I saw her on television, and I thought, wow, that's the girl I talked to. I mean, maybe she was more famous than I knew. And then I kept on seeing her television. Then I realized she had a series, and this was Ellen DeGeneres. And then I would go to award shows, and I would see her. I don't think she remembered me from years ago. So finally I said, I'd really like to have you come and speak at my school. And she said, I don't know. She didn't seem to be very interested. And then finally, I asked a lot of people to teach, and I managed to talk to Dustin Hoffman and Alec Baldwin into doing a class. They were each going to take half a Saturday. I remember because it was around my birthday. This was 8-10 years ago. So they both agreed, and I thought, well, I'm in a role. Maybe I should try it for more. So I saw Ellen at a show. I said, hey, Ellen, I got a great idea. Alec Baldwin, Dustin Hoffman are teaching each a half a day at Paramount. Maybe you could come in Sunday. She said, I'd do that. I thought, great. So she said she'd come. So I was very excited. I thought, what a weekend. And we immediately sold out the Saturday with Alec and Dustin. And some people enrolled with Dustin, with Ella, but not as many. So I got very excited. They got to be 2 weeks before the event. And all of a sudden, Dustin Hoffman, secretary, calls and says, well, Dustin can't make it. Well, I said, why is that? She said, well, he's got to pick up his kids. I thought, pick up his kids? I thought, well, how about the next week? No. Well, how about the week after that? No. We can't come? No. She said, all summer, he's taking a trip with his kids. He just can't do it. I went, okay. And then Alex's secretary called me, and I knew he was going to court. It was something about he punched somebody, or somebody bothered him, he got an argument, and the person took him to court. He said, he's got to get ready for court. So they dropped out. So I thought, oh, gee, that's not good. I'm going to have to refund everyone's money, too. So this guy was getting famous. He wasn't very famous then, but I started to try and find him. His name was Russell Crowe. And I thought, well, maybe I'd get him to speak. I couldn't get him to speak, so it was just Ellen. So I tried to leave a message at Ellen's office. I don't know if she got it. So she came there that day. I told her 500 people would be coming, because that's how many were coming Saturday. There was like 75 people in the audience. She showed up with Anne, who she was going to, was going with them at that time. Whatever it was, 10, 12 years ago. And she said, well, how many people are there? I said, not a big group. And she was there with her manager. She said, well, why did you lie to me? I said, they didn't lie to you. This all happened abruptly, and I thought I left a message. She said, no, really, I should go home. I said, well, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to. I hope you don't. She said, I'm just going to stay for a few minutes so I don't disappoint people. I said, fine. And she went in. And Anne sat next to me because Ellen was annoyed. She sat on the other side of Anne. And we started to videotape it. Ellen said, I don't want to videotape. I said, it's up to you. So we stopped the videotape. Then I don't want to go on a long story, but my mother was there. And I just thought, oh, I don't know, this isn't good. It was my birthday, too. And I thought, you tell my mother's a bad person, but you know how a Jewish-type mother is. Just, they do things that make you feel uncomfortable. And I just hoped she wouldn't do that. But I couldn't think of that. I had a lot of things in my mind. So we started the session. I started to introduce it. Next thing I know, my mother stands up. I'm thinking, no, she raises her hand for a question. And I did what I said, my mother. I said, well, in the first row, what would you like to say? So she got up with her back towards me and addressed the audience. Hi, I'm Gary Shusett's mother. I'm thinking, oh, this is so humiliating. She said, today is Gary's birthday. I look over at Ellen, she's rolling her eyes. I'm thinking, I'm sorry, I didn't do anything. She says, isn't that wonderful? And people applaud. I'm thinking, oh, it's bad enough, I'm having a tough day. Then she says, I think we should all wish and sing happy birthday to Gary. I'm thinking, this is torture. God, why is she doing this to me? So they're singing happy birthday. And Ellen's shaking her head. I feel like crawling into a hole. So it ends. So I said, well, that was interesting, thank you. So I start asking questions. And I ask about, you know, 15. They seem okay. You know, questions about their career and what's it like doing TV series and whatever they're asking. And I see the manager on the side going, you know, like, wrap it up. You know, it's about wrap, you know. No, he sends me a note. I threw that crap. Ellen's been here 15 minutes. I think you should let her leave. So I think, okay. So I say, I don't want to talk to Ellen. I say, so Ellen, I understand you two have somewhere to be. You've been nice to talk to a group, and if you need to go somewhere, that's okay. She says, no, it's fine. I said, okay, we could talk a little bit more. So we talk some more, and we talk another half hour. And then finally the guy sends me another. He says, I mean it this time. Let them go. Let them go home. You've held them long enough. And I'm going, I can't help them. So I say, well, Ann, okay, you've given us a full hour. That's great. You know, if you need to go for any reason, believe me, you won't be disappointing us. So no one can stay. And this time he's really shaking his head. And he's turning red. And he said to me, I'm going to wring your neck unless you let them go. So finally they talk for a few minutes later. And I don't even say. I say, well, I think we should end now. And so they leave. And manager leaves. So I'm thinking, I say to Ellen, well, thank you for coming. She said, it was okay. Like, she didn't seem so upset. We've been talking about journalism and what we do, but it's a little bit hard to comprehend without knowing specifically what it is we do. Ever since many years ago, I changed from having a big school with a lot of big classroom, famous people speaking to crowds. We changed a whole different structure. And that structure is several times a year, somewhere between 16 and 20, and we have theme classes we do. Like we'll do 3 or 4 days with agents, 3 or 4 days with executives, 3 or 4 days with actors and directors, companies. So that's what we do. So let's just say, we just recently did this. We did a class with actors, directors, companies. And we had Natalie Portman's company, and we had Steve Carell's company, and we had David Duchovny's company, and Joe Dante's company. You know, a bunch of companies, most of them pretty well known, Pierce Brosnan's company. So we work out of Hollywood. So we rent a van, and the group meets us in Hollywood, and people park their car usually, we take that van, and we'll go somewhere. Well, the reason why we did the very first stop we made on that Wednesday morning was Warner Brothers, because it's easier to get the students, not the students, easier to get the guests, but it's harder to get the screening room and conference. We got a conference room at Warner Brothers. So people will come in one at a time, and they'll sit and they'll talk with our group, and they'll talk about the nature of that company and how they develop movies for Todd Phillips, who did Hangover, or Steve Carell, whoever. And then at the end of that hour session, the moderator will say, these people enjoyed you. Would they be allowed to give you a one-sheet synopsis? Oddly enough, in most situations, the first words out of anybody who puts their mouth is, we cannot take unsolicited material. But oddly enough, because the group is small, because they seem talented, I would say 90% of the time that guest says, sure, if you have an envelope with one-page synopsis, I'd be willing to take it. So that's what we do. And sometimes we'll go to a different place. So we have lunch at the commissary, the executive boardroom there, and then we went to the Beverly Hills Hotel. We talked to Will Smith's company and Sam Raimi's company and other companies there. So basically we'll plan 3 days and we'll go to one or two places a day. and we'll talk to people. In that particular time, not only did we have companies, later on we had directors. Peter Himes talked to us, and Mike Farrell talked to us, and Richard Benjamin talked to us, because we're intermixing very big companies with people who are actors, not necessarily Tom Cruise level, but actors who act and know a lot about that. And that follows the structures. Our idea is, can we communicate with the industry is like, at the same time, can they intermingle with these guests so they can perhaps make a connection with them? And that's exactly what we try and do. And also, sometimes we'll have another day out of the pitching. And it won't be the pitching you usually see, because I think the most valuable part of pitching is not that you're getting a movie made, but somebody will give you feedback. And that's typical of a Sherwood Oaks day or a Sherwood Oaks class. Of course, the other aspect is not a class, but it may be as important, if not more exciting. And that's, we're the only school in the United States that year-round actually brings new and upcoming talent to award shows. We'll go to the Producers Guild, the Writers Guild, Directors Guild, even 100 Stars, the Emmys, and we'll buy maybe 10 tickets. Maybe we'll have a table at the Producers Guild. And we'll sit there and we'll watch the awards given out. And before the show, after the show, I'll bring many nominees over and they'll talk to us. And I think people really, really like that. And during our regular classes, we have a pattern. We'll bring people to conference rooms and screening rooms. So that's typical of Sherwood Oaks and what we do with our structure. Pitching is more than pitching. You're more than pitching your story. You're really pitching yourself. So the question is, are you smart enough to know what kind of movies Hollywood makes? Are you smart enough to know how you explain things in few words? Are you smart enough to know what kind of material is attractive to actors? So when you're thinking of the thing you're going to write and the thing you're going to pitch, can you cover these bases with a minimal amount of words? And the idea of a pitching session is not talking them into it. An idea that people have is, I'll sit down in front of the producer, if I talk all 5 minutes, I'll somehow convince them. All you do is convince them, never want to talk to you again, I'm now relieving your hand. Because all you did was just ramble on about yourself. The real goal is to get that person you're talking to do more talking to you. That means it's involved. And the way you do that is, the first 4 to 8 words in your mouth is the whole pitch. If you fail there, you failed. Because if you do a little bit bad, he's not listening. So you have to come out gangbusters and figure some way out, what 8 words can I say so that person says, to himself, that sounds interesting. Or if someone taps me on the shoulder when you finish, I would say, don't bother me, I gotta hear this person's pitch. That has to be your goal. If you haven't done that, you're failing and probably will fail. So that's the orientation first. How few words can you say, not how many words, and what can you say first? Usually more about the theme than the structure. And if you go on and talk 2 or 3 times, you'll get more and more on the structure. How writers fail, by far, too many words, too much detail. Details I don't care. They were married, they got divorced, then they realized they were in love, really, so they got married again. Why do I care about that? What I care about is, his wife was neurotic, he almost felt like killing her, and then he realized she had this great quality, and they did this and this. They took a trip around the world, or something more interesting now. But I'm saying these details, marrying, falling out of love, are not what's interesting.
Now, you've made a movie yourself, correct?
A couple movies.
And one of the movies that you made, how did you pitch that?
Well, it's interesting. It was a remake, and I looked at not just one remake, I looked at 800 movies, of which 750 were terrible. And I looked at the other 50, and 20 were good. I got it down to about 5 really good movies, and my idea of what I was looking for was good, was not famous, not successful, but a very interesting idea that hadn't been explored and be updated. So that's what I looked for. So I looked through many hundreds of Universal movies. I found 2 or 3 I really, really liked. I was working with the partner. We agreed. We thought we could get this movie made if we showed it to the right person. So we showed it to a few people, Dan Aykroyd and John Lithgow and other people, Jack Nicholson, but he never really looked at it, Bill Murray. And finally I said, fortunately, I knew Richard Dreyfuss. Richard had taught for me, so I had a connection. And again, this is typical how movies get made. Richard is my friend, so whatever I tell him, he's going to look at. But I was sincere. I said, Richard, I have this movie I really like. I didn't say much about it, so I just want you to look at it, see if you like it. And he looked at it, he said, Gary, I really like this movie. I'm very interested in taking part, and that's what he told me. So I was excited. Then I thought, well, who's worked with Richard? So I found the director that I knew the director, he knew Richard. Good idea, let's combine them. So I called this director, and he knew me well. I used to call him up all the time and say, can you come speak? So I called him up, he comes to the phone, he said, yeah, Gary, what do you want? I said, well, I'd like you to. He said, you want me to come speak again? No, not really. I'm producing movies. He goes, hey, pal, I can't help you. In fact, I got to get back to my movie. And I said to him, no, it's not how you can help me. It's how I can help you. And he was very irritated at this statement. I usually don't act this way, but I was desperate. He said, what did you just say to me? Like, how dare you? And I said, look, I'm really remaking bad movies. You're a complete idiot. You're more idiotic than I ever realized, and there's no reason to continue this conversation. And he paused. That short pause, I said to him, you know, one of these movies I have is about the world's worst actor in Hollywood, and he gets the greatest role of his life. He goes, oh yeah? The chance to play a real-life dictator. And there's a silence. He hung up on the phone to me. I thought, okay, you win some, you lose some. He plainly didn't like this. I hear groaning on the phone. I think, what's wrong? I said, are you okay? I'm thinking, oh my God, he had a heart attack. He's going to die. I'm going to be blamed. I said, are you sick? Are you okay? He goes, I'm fine. What's wrong? I like what you told me. I said, what? He said, I really like this. Meaning, he couldn't believe he liked it. And he said, I really like what you told me. I said, what? That's great. He said, well, you sent it to me. I said, no. Well, what's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? I tell you, I got the problem. He said, no, I want to meet with you. And he says, I'm too important for you to meet with. Well, I said, I understand. I'm busy. I said, well, how long have you been busy for? A year. I'm going to be plugging away. Slams down the phone. He made the movie. The movie was called Moon River Parador. That's in the best of all situations. He was upset at me. I said the right things in the right way. He liked it. But it shows you, and partly was talent. I did say it the right way, and I had the right piece of material. So you can't get someone to make a movie over the phone, but you can get someone to at least read your material. That's a minimal. That's what you want to do. So that's what could happen at its best. Doesn't happen that way, but a very good thing can happen. He likes what you said. He thinks you're intelligent. He'll read your material.
I have just come to Hollywood. I've been writing for a while,
okay.
And I'd like to get some coaching and
sure.
feedback.
Right.
I understand that you can kind of push forward a little hard sometimes on it, but I've heard great things about your ability to help me with pitching. And one of the things I know is I want to get people to read my script. It's really important to me. But what I'm realizing is that if I can't pitch it right, then, and if I can't pitch it to get them to want to read it, no one's going to read it and my film's not going to get made.
Well, I think you're already ahead of some people because the fact you realize that is a positive. That's what you're saying is absolutely correct.
So, why don't I give an example of a pitch and then you tell me
yes.
how I could possibly
sure.
improve it. So, there's about a guy who's in action. He's trying to actually save the world, but he forgets who he is. And through this, he goes around the world, and he has about 10 different identities, you know, 8 different passports. He's traveling around the world. There's lots of action sequences. People are trying to kill him. He's a spy, and it's a fantastic read. What do you think about it?
Well, I think that's a vague way of describing it. I've heard this from other people, but I'm thinking about it. I think one could easily say, of all those words you say, a lot of pitches about the economy of words, the surprising thing generally is surprising how few words one should say, and it should be few words, to describe or give the feeling of your script. You don't have to tell a thing. So somebody would say, if you wanted to keep economy, just get a thought across, you'd say, well, I have a movie, it's kind of like a guy, about James Bond guy with amnesia. That's someone would say, that's the economy of words. James Bond with amnesia. It sounds good. You don't have to describe all the details. And then later on, after you say that, they might say, you know, tell me some more, and you tell more of the plot.
So, you mean the Osborne identity, you could get it down to four words like that. Well, so anyone could figure this out, and anyone could realize
it. The idea is for anyone there is, and people could do if they think hard enough, realize what to do, is to get their pitch. In the beginning, it doesn't have to be, in other words, you go to a pitch event and you introduce yourself, and the first words out of your mouth should be a very small number of words, and the words that gives the feeling of the script. It doesn't have to give the strip structure. My brother called me up several years ago, and he's a very successful writer. He said, Gary, I've optioned a short story, which I like very much, for the writer's script. And I mentioned it to you, but tell me before I write, I'm curious what you think of it. I said, sure. He says, well, it takes place in the future, and this script is about police would develop a system. And that system is they can arrest criminals before they commit the crime. And fairly had the words got out of his mouth. I'm thinking, I've never heard this. It sounds great. It seems like a great part for someone. And even though I know he's talented, I think if anybody called me up, person never made any, said that to me, I would have said, that's a movie. Obviously, I was right. My brother was right. That movie became Minority Report and made $300 or $400 million worldwide and attracted Steve Spielberg and Tom Cruise. So that's the ideal pitch. Scripts cannot also always necessarily be that good, but can get a lot closer than they usually are.
Now, one thing that people have told me is that the reason why the economy of words is so important is it's a little bit about the telephone game, where a lot of people have to recite your pitch many times before that movie gets made.
That's
correct.
True? That's correct. So in other words, let's say you pitch to me, and let's say I'm the story editor I'm not the head of a company, but we make movies, and I'm listening, I come to a pitch, you tell me, I'm thinking that's good. So if I go and I describe to my boss, I was there, we have a meeting Monday, usually have a group meeting at most companies, we're there. So did you hear anything good? Yeah. This woman came up to me, she was pitching me at the event we did on Sunday. She was saying, some other guy that, you know, he's an action hero and he managed to kill all the villains, but he just kept on forgetting about things. If I said that, they go, well, I don't know, sounds okay. Well, in Hollywood, okay is not good enough. Hollywood's like the binary system of computers. A light switches on, a light switches off. Unless it's great, it's no good at all. So if I said to him, yeah, you know what she said to me? She said it's James Bond with amnesia. Well, I just said what you said, word for word. That's the ideal thing. And I'm sure my boss would say, God, that sounds great. Does she have a script? Yeah, she's sending it to it. And he said, tell me when it comes out, I want to read it. I'm thinking, if she writes it really great, that could be a movie. But I'm thinking, if she doesn't, it's not a movie. And that's called execution-oriented. So in other words, great execution becomes a movie. I do not, nor does my boss, nor anyone in our company have time to read every single script that I've executed great would be a movie. We want a script that sounds so great, even if the person misses, we can still make a movie out of it. We can fire her, get another writer, and write a great script. And that's what everybody's looking for. So you can have sort of an idea expressed in sort of an average way. That's what you need to keep away from. It has to be like, the minute words come out of a person's mouth, you go, oh my God! You never do that. You go, oh my God, remember? You just go, oh God, this girl's great, she said that. You have to be thinking, I can't wait to tell my boss. That's your goal. And I know it's very, very hard. And the way you do that is, do not work on a script that comes to your mind one day. Spend months and months thinking of ideas. 10 ideas, 50 ideas, 100 ideas, and then take your four best ideas and go around to anyone that's working in the industry. They could be an editor, they could be a co-producer, they could be an actor, and the reason you want them is they're used to being in movies, hearing about movies. And by the way, when you tell your friends, you don't have to be good at telling your friends that much, because for them, you're only trying to express the idea. You don't want to go on and on. You just want them to tell about the idea, how does it sound. So we've been talking a lot about the school and pitching, taking classes. So in order to understand exactly how we operate, me in particular with pitching, we're going to give you an example of what happens in a pitching session with me. And remember that I'm telling you, and I always tell the pitcher, I'm not like anyone else. I'm brutally honest. I stop people out, and I tell them what I like and don't like, and I explain what's wrong. And this is what all writers need from everybody. I wish there were 500 people doing what I was doing. There's only a couple, and I'm one, unfortunately. So now I'm going to show you something in action. Maybe it'll help you understand what's good and what's not good about people trying to pitch, how they're operating, how they should operate.
I work in Silicon Valley, and it is the most exciting, fascinating place to work. We have startups, We have people stealing ideas. We have parties.
Wait, stop right there. You say you have a script. The backdrop is sort of like the story show Sling That, where the backdrop is computers, the people become wealthy. And what is the actual story about, not the excitement, the individual scenes? Tell me, what's the point of your movie? Like, the movie ends, I go see it, and I go, wow, these people are clever, intelligent, or idiots, or immoral. What is the theme, not the plot of your story, about whether it, what's the title of your movie?
Engineers Know How to Have Fun.
Okay. That's not the title you want to have. It sounds like they could be train engineers, that could be electrical. It's the wrong title, but that's not important. The title could change. But it feels like you're giving me scenes. I don't hear a plot, and forget Gary Chassette. Anyone you tell it to that way, they would just say, I don't see where the story is. I see where the backdrop is. I see why that movie was in it, Social Network, how people would be interested. But what is... Who are the characters? What happens at the end? What happens at the end of your movie? What happens in your movie?
Well, people live happily ever after.
Well, they usually do. But the question is, why do I care about them? It would, a plot would be, this is a guy about who's always a geek. I'm making up, so I really about your story. I'm just giving you an example. More or less what it could be or should be. This guy who's a geek, and he meets a fellow geek. People make fun of him, they don't dress well. And they have a job, they catch them to get a job or make much money. And one of them has an idea. You know, said, what if we did this? And the other guy says, oh, nobody would be interested in that. He said, but you know what they might be interested in if we tried this? And they do that. And they meet with failure. And pretty soon, they actually have success. And that success goes to a huge success. But then one of them, he just loses control with the amount of money he's getting, and he thinks he really did it, and he thinks, I don't want to be partners with you because I'm the one that did that. And the other guy thinks that's not right. So maybe what he does is, whatever it calls for, you could have him kill him, you could have him, he frames him so he goes to jail so he can take over the business. Something, the plot isn't the fact they got wealthy and famous. The plot is the dynamics between them when money arose and what happened to them and what happens at the end. Now, I didn't think a very good plot. I was just trying to put drama in your plot so it had a structure. Maybe he goes to prison, he comes out, and then he feels sorry he did it, and maybe they do something different. Or maybe he actually kills him, and his brother comes back and tries to get back at him. Not that that should be the plot. I'm trying to invent a story for you. It's not good, but that is a plot.
So what you're saying is, when you go to Sherwood Oaks, or if I do a pitching or a coaching session with you, what you're saying is you're going to allow me and give me some coaching.
Absolutely.
Here on goes. How to not just make my pitch, but also to give me some ideas on how to be successful.
Absolutely, totally.
And also, from what I've been heard from you, is that you're going to be able to help me with getting some key contacts so that not only can I gain insight, but you're also saying that I can gain contacts to actually have them help me make my movie.
Yeah, first let me talk about the pitching. If you go to any of our classes, there's usually two components of pitching. There's me. And sometime during that class, whether it's a lunch or dinner, or if somebody moves to different times, a free hour, I will actually start going through people's pitches briefly. I don't want to spend an hour with each person. Somebody will go around the table. I say, well, someone give me a pitch. We can go through five pitches at lunch. And I will say, this is what's weak. This is what you should do. And they'll say, and they might come up later. In addition to that, in a lot of our classes, like, we'll have 3 days with agents and managers, and they'll come and they'll speak, and then the last day will be a fourth day. We will do pitching. It's not the pitching you have somewhere else, because I believe the most valuable part of the pitching is when you get the feedback. They won't necessarily make your movie, but you'll come in, let's say, we keep the last day small, 12 people or something. So those 12 people will meet 6 producers. And so they will get 6 different versions of feedback. So if all 6 of those producers, or 4 of them, say, you know, it was a good pitch, but it really had a disappointing ending, then you're thinking, wow, 4 people said that. Maybe they're right. And for all I know, all 6 will say it's great the way it is. Not likely. They'll probably say, this is what I liked about your pitch. This is what you're missing. So 2 different ways you'll get pitching. Now, what Christine was saying here is, we'll do that. In addition to that, the whole point of taking our classes is, again, not to make the movie that week. we're having a class coming up in August. And we're the only ones who've done this. We've done this 2 or 3 years in a row. When you go to a pitch event, you will often have the lowest person on the totem. There'll be the assistant. There'll be someone answers the phone. They might be a reader. You're lucky, a story editor. They certainly won't be the head of a company. No head of a company comes to a pitching event. It just doesn't work that. But the opposite, Sherwood Oaks has all heads of companies. Head of a studio, head of a major company, vice president of a studio, vice. So you have major people coming, meeting with our people. We don't give one sheet. So your sheet very well goes by or to among, if not the most important person in the session. Not only that, we do this, now we've done this once or twice a year. We have the biggest actors' companies send people, not the head of their company, not the actor himself, but the story editor, the person that runs it. So we have Johnny Depp's company, Will Smith's company, Will Ferrell's company, Steve Carell's company, Morgan Freeman's company, David Duchovny's company, major, major people. Some of these people, if they get into new script, actually could get the movie made. So theoretically, you came to Will Smith's session, the company has come twice, and Will, the guy who's an executive, he's fairly high up in the company. If he loves this idea, you read your one sheet, he gets the script, I'd say the next person to that is the head of that company. And if he likes that, and he gives it to the head of Will Smith's company, probably your movie is being developed or made. That's rare, not easy to do. I'm not saying that will happen the first week, but it could happen, especially bring in 18 guests and 12 can get movies made. And your movie's a really interesting idea. It's not far-fetched, something could happen. So I was saying, I think that one of the knocks I seem to have is when I talk to anyone and they're interested in doing something with me, it seems obvious someone who has whatever quality people seem to like. So I had seen that in Sid Field, and does that very often. So this guy comes and he said, well, it comes up and we're looking for screenwriting teachers. Usually I get really well-known people, but occasionally someone comes that's not well-known and they seem to be just a great gift for communicating. So the guy comes in, I never heard him say his name. He says he's going to teach at SC, and he was originally an actor, and he wants to teach screenwriting. And he didn't say very much. He said, well, I think I'd be interested in teaching. And I said, stop right there. He said, what's wrong? Nothing's wrong. I said, I think I want you here. He said, I didn't tell you about myself. I said, I don't have to hear anything more. He said, what do you know about me? I said, I know a lot about you just in what you're talking. He said, I can teach you, so I'd like to have you teach. So he starts teaching, and I was exactly right. Whatever he had, it was obvious. And within weeks, he becomes as a more popular in Sid Field. His numbers start growing. First, it was 20, 50. Pretty soon, we can't find a big enough room for the guy. And he gets, and he's unbelievably popular. And he teaches me, and then we move eventually. We have a smaller place, so we're downsizing. Goes off on his own, he starts teaching. And then he becomes huge. Becomes the most popular screenwriting teacher that there's ever been. He told me, and I know he wasn't making up, he was actually taking in $1 million a year. His name was Bob McKee. And that's the story of how Bob McKee began. I didn't make him famous, but I was at least able to recognize the quality he had in him that made Bob McKee what was Bob McKee. I somehow, and I didn't study to do this, I'm able to immediately correct a pitch. Somebody will give me a pitch that, in my opinion, is weak. It's not working. And I can instantly tell them why it's not working. But better than that, I can actually give them a word-for-word better version. And one of the ways I do this is, whenever they start talking to me, I usually interrupt them very early. Not because I think the pitch is bad. It's because I want to remember how my emotions or what I'm thinking of when someone says blank, blank, blank. Me representing producers thinking, gee, I didn't like that at all because it seemed exactly like a very famous movie. Or it seemed like they'll never sell that because it's too depressing. Okay, so I'm saying that I think I have a unique ability and I'm not afraid to say something that might be very critical because I think I could give something to them that in the end they realize is valuable. And it's hard to improve in any area it is, whether it's shooting baskets, or making a pot, or making a pitch. In order to get better on anything, writing, pitching, you have to have someone give you feedback so you can prove that things are not doing that good. So that's an introduction to what I do in pitching feedback.